Il y a quelques semaines, j'ai pris le train pour aller à la rencontre de Robeux. C'est un hacker éthique qui a à son compteur 34 CVE. Dans cette liste se trouvent des failles critiques sur les systèmes d'Amazon et Nvidia. Il était même passé en 2021 dans les journaux belges après avoir trouvé une faille sur les systèmes d'une banque européenne qui lui a permis d'être millionnaire en l'espace d'une journée. En plus d'être un excellent pentester, c'est aussi l'un des rares créateurs de contenu en cyberoffensive en Europe. Il détient une chaîne YouTube du nom de Pink Draconian avec un super sens de la vulgarisation. Je vous invite à vous abonner à celle-ci. On vous a produit deux vidéos techniques. Ces vidéos seront en anglais, sous-titrées en français. Si vous aimez ce type de contenu, n'hésitez pas à me le faire savoir en laissant un pouce bleu et dans l'espace commentaire. C'est parti pour la vidéo. So, Robert, what are you gonna show us today?
So I have this really cool application. It's called Notes of Secrecy. The tagline is "You write it, we hide it." And I wanna hack this application. I want to find a way to find or read the notes of somebody else. So this application is really simple. It has two functionalities. You can write something. So I'm author test, write some test note with the content test. And then says note was added successfully. And now I can find my test note once again. And then it shows up as a test note. And that's kind of everything we have to work with here. Now, we need to hack this. So obviously I've been capturing all my traffic in Burpsuit like you do. In this case, we have our Burpsuit open and we have one post request to slash note and one get request to get note. And one thing we notice here is that with get note, we supply an author and the name and it then returns us that note. So, well, probably we could supply somebody else's author name and somebody else's note name and by that way steal their note. But we don't really have much to go off of right now. Luckily, we also have the source code here. So one thing that we always must do is look at the source code to make sure that we don't miss anything and that we know exactly how this works. So I have the source code open here. It's very simple. It starts an Express application, web server. It gets the flag and a message from slash flag. It sets up Express. It then creates a database of notes. And for the flag, so the note with the name flag will have the content of message and then the author, the traveler. So we know that the author, the traveler, wrote a note with the name that is the flag. So if we can figure out what that name is, well, then obviously we have the flag. But if you noticed in our get request here, we needed the author's name, which we now have, the traveler, and the name of the note to actually get the contents of the note. So we cannot just use this API call, because if we use this API call, well, then pretty much we have solved the challenge because we have the flag. Then we have to dig deeper into the specific implementation here of how we get a note. And we see some interesting stuff happening here. First of all, we get the note name from the request query. Dot name, like we saw earlier. And then if our note name is a string, then we are going to do an MD5 of our note name. So we're going to hash our note name and make an MD5 hash of the note name. That's presumably what it uses to make like an ID of a note. Mm-hmm. And that way you can get it. The author is then also taken from the request query. So from a get parameter, the authors is then used to look through the notes database. And if it finds a note with that name and the author being equal to the author that we supplied, then it will make a list of all the notes that this author has made. And then in those notes by that author, it will check if the MD5 hash of any of the names of the stored notes matches whatever you supplied in a request. So that's kind of a weird way of checking if notes belong to somebody and then getting a note. That's kind of interesting.
What's the first thing that you have in mind when you see this kind of code?
When I see this kind of code, I, you know, it's not something that if I would write this, I would write it way differently. And I think that's something you have to look out for. And that's also why I think it's important that people learn to code to become a good hacker. Because once you see some code that isn't behaving like you would write it, then some shaky stuff might be going on. And in this case, it definitely looks like it. The fact that these names are MD5'd is strange. And the fact that here it checks if our note name is a string, that to me is also a red flag, because I know that what I supply in the request query isn't necessarily a string. like I could, and let's do that, let's go into burp suit, I could supply the name as an array. And now if we send that, we see that it doesn't work anymore because now the name is actually an array. And that's something you need to be aware of, that that's possible. So if we supply a name that is an array, then we kind of bypass this because we won't make the MD5 of the node name. So somewhere already something shaky is going on here. But it gets more shaky because if we look at how it compares these two MD5 hashes at the end, it does if compare node name and node ID. But this compare is a custom function. It's not something default to JavaScript. So I think we definitely need to look into that compare function. And if we scroll down, we have the compare function here. It's going to take two node IDs. It's going to then loop over the first node ID and check that every character matches the character. So it's going to check the first character of the first node ID and the first character of the second node ID. And if those match, then it's going to go to the next character and so on. But then it also does this call here to isValid chunk of the node ID dot slice of the first of the 24 next characters of the node ID. So seemingly in this for loop where it's comparing the two strings, it's then also checking if the string is valid. And if we go to this isValid chunk function here, then we see that this is using a regex to test if a chunk of a node ID is hexadecimal. Because obviously MD5 only makes hexadecimal, so this is going to check if it's actually hexadecimal. But this regex is interesting, and whenever I see complex regexes, there's always one thing that I always check, and that is whether they're vulnerable for something called REDOS, or regex denial of service. And what does that mean? It can be very imperformant, so it can take a lot of time for some regex functions to complete. And a lot of time, I mean up to 1,000 seconds if you have a very long regex that is vulnerable. So we have to check that out. And here I already see it might be vulnerable because there is some shaky stuff going on where it starts with a dot asterisk, which means match anything followed by a specific character. You know, if I supply specific ranges, then it might be vulnerable. But there's some website that we can use to check this out. So if you just search like REDOS finder, then you might find here an REDOS checker. And in this place, you can literally just paste in your regex and it will say whether it's vulnerable or not. And here you can see that indeed this is vulnerable. And if you enter a lot of zeros and then check it, it might cause some timing issues. For every character we check in the compare function, this regex is executed. So if we can force it somehow that the timing is different when a correct character is checked versus when an incorrect character is checked, then we may be able to kind of force timing differences and that way get something out of it. And that's something that we have to play around with, I guess. So
just to understand, by the delay, you're going to know if a character is valid or not, right?
Yeah, we could. And I'll show you how that might work. So let's just quickly go into a node shell here. And then we can set a regex and we can test a string. So if we test anything, it will say true or false, depending on if it matches. If we type a very, very long string, then we see it goes instantly. But I think now if we finish our very, very long string with something that doesn't match us, now we see it takes a long time. And that's because it's looping over all of these A's and it's recursively, I think, going through all of these A's. As you can see, we still haven't gotten a response yet.
Yeah.
So that's something we can play around with. It still hasn't gotten a response. This shows how long it can take for these regexes to complete. So just this simple line of code can cause a really big security issue in your code. And in this case, we can actually exploit that because we see here that whenever we are looping through the characters, it's always going to check the next 24 characters of our node. So let's say that we supply an A followed by 22 zeros, times, followed by an exclamation point. Now this is going to be false. let's say we have a string that we know already. Like we know that it starts with F followed by a zero. And then we want to test if A is correct or not. If we do it like this with 23 zeros and an exclamation point followed, if the A is incorrect, then it won't check these 24 characters. It will just check A followed by 23 zeros, which is the 24 characters it checks. It won't have a timing issue. If it then decides A is the correct number or the correct letter, then it will continue one step. And then it will include this exclamation point, causing this timing issue to happen. And that's kind of what we're going to exploit. This is the attack script that I wrote. We can see that here it has a call to localhost 3000 to get a note for the author traveler. And the character set we're going to try to attack is the all the digits plus ABCDEF, so just hexadecimals. And this is kind of the important part here, where it tests a character. So it's going to create a test string, which is the part of the node it already knows, plus a random character. It's then going to add these 22 zeros, like we said earlier, and an exclamation point. It's then going to send the request and time the differences between the two requests. And it will then print out the time, and then we can see like how much time did it take for these to complete. And if we run that script, so we can Python solution attack.py, then we see very quickly it tested the character 0, which resulted in almost no time, the character 1 as well, and so on. But for the character F, it actually took 0.1 seconds mm-hmm. instead of the 0.02 characters that we had here. So there's clearly a timing issue that is being exploited here by exploiting that REDOS that we have. So that is very, very interesting. And this script, it's super simple. I generated it with ChatGPT, like I do with all my exploit scripts. I just tell it what I want to happen, and it does it. So it's all pretty much generated. I didn't have to do any writing code myself, because I would never in my exploit scripts write documentation for the exploit. I would never, ever do that. That's a very big giveaway. So this was all ChatGPT, and the only thing that I wrote myself here was this interesting part where the payload gets formatted. And that's something we haven't solved yet, because if I go back to the code, right now, if I get a node, my node name is obviously going to get MD5'd, right? MD5 cannot contain an exclamation point, so we cannot do our exploit, because we need that character that is not hexadecimal to actually exploit it. So before we can continue with that exploit script, we need to figure out how we can actually introduce characters that are not hexadecimal into our node name. And that can seem very difficult, but we've actually already covered the issue here. And the issue here is that it checks if the node name is a string, and only if it is a string, we make the MD5 of that node name. So if we supply the node name as not being a string, then we can actually exploit this. And how does it work? Well, so we have a curl command here, and we supply the node name as being an array. Then the first character of our array can, for example, be an A. And then we can supply the second character as B. And what will this do? In node, this will pass in the name parameter, so rec.query.name, as an array of characters with the first index being A, the second index being B. And by doing that, we can actually put one of them as an exclamation point, and that will work perfectly fine. The name will now not be a string, so it won't be MD5'd. So we skip this, and then our node name is directly used in the compare function down below, where we have now passed in an array. And just by chance in the compare function, it doesn't matter if this is a string or an array, because it's just going to index it. And strings are kind of arrays of characters, and we pass in an array of characters, so that still works. So in our attack script, I will print out what these payloads look like. So if I print out the payload formatted and then run the attack again, then that will give a better idea of what we're actually doing here. So as you can see, this is kind of what one request would now look like. We're testing the character 9, followed by a lot of zeros. And as you can see, this is just one big array. And then at the end of the array, we have the exclamation point. So these are the types of requests that are constantly being sent. And if the name starts with a specific letter that is correct, then it will cause a timing issue. And that way, eventually, we can exfiltrate a node by a specific user. So let's just let that script run, I think, and then see what it shows us. So if we run the script, see it happens quite fast, actually. It's just doing its attack with all the timing. And for example, here, as you can see, for the character B here, it took a lot longer than for the other characters. If I scroll down, we actually have the flag. Well, here it says flag. It's not exactly the flag. It's just the node ID for the flag.
And it could be also a password or anything.
Yeah, exactly. Anything. If we want the real flag, then we'll obviously have to pass in this node as the node name. So if I set the name to be equal to that, then we see it doesn't work. And that's because obviously it's now going to MD5 this text.
Mm-hmm.
So we now need to kind of pass this into the request as that array format that we did earlier. So that's going to be a little bit of a pain, but we can quickly code that in Python, I guess. So we have this string and now for every character of that string, we actually want to pass and name array is equal to that character. And then we see that we get that format and then we just join it together. And then we kind of have the string that we need to pass into our curl commands. My author needs to be the traveler. And just like that, we get a lot of text and we hear get the flag, which is I smell notes of you hacking me. Congratulations. And that is kind of how you solve this challenge with an RE DOS that you can exploit because of some other issues in the code. And the goal of the challenge was to kind of showcase that RE DOS is a real issue. And also with timing attacks being so interesting these days, maybe this combination can be used more in the wild.
I have a question for you because we had the code first, so we could do a code review. Yeah. If you didn't have the code, do you have any way to automate the detection and the exploitation?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's going to be very difficult to find this blindly, although timing differences is always something you need to look out for. I would highly recommend looking into what James Kettle is doing at PortSwigger. So he has built some amazing tooling into Burp Suite as well, where you can, it automatically tries to elicit these kinds of timing attacks. So I think that's definitely something to start with. Where I see this working the best is in open source projects where you actually have access to the code and you can try to look for these regexes. But then maybe when you find these regexes, also think that they will probably have been reused in other projects as well. So whenever you sense that somewhere a regex is being used, it can always be useful to try and input very long strings that match and then don't match at the end to just check, is there going to be a timing difference? I've only found this in the wild like 2 or 3 times. And that is just because I brute force every single input field that's possible. For every input field that I find, I put a backslash at the end just to check, is there maybe something happening there? I make it very long. I remove it entirely. I do a lot of brute forcing, and then sometimes you notice, hey, this request takes very long. And even then still, I don't know if it's a regex that's causing the issue or something else, of course. So maybe those two instances that I'm talking about are not even RE DOSes. They're just what I thought would have been that. But these are very difficult to find in the wild, but can be quite impactful.
C'est ainsi que s'achève cette première partie. Il y a une autre vidéo prévue avec Robeux qui sera postée dans les semaines à venir. Pour ne pas la louper, n'oubliez pas de vous abonner à la chaîne, c'est très important. Aussi, laissez un pouce bleu si la vidéo vous a plu, un commentaire. Merci d'avoir suivi cette vidéo. Je vous dis à la vidéo prochaine.